Revelation 20. And I saw an angel coming down out of heaven, having the key to the abyss and holding in his hand a great chain. He seized the dragon, that ancient serpent who is the devil or Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years.
All right, so this angel comes down to the prison or the abyss where Satan lives, or at least where Satan is in the dream or at this time, and he seizes Satan like a prisoner and binds him for a really long time. And again, this 1,000 years should not be viewed as a literal 1,000 years or 1,365 days. This is symbolic language. So I don't claim to have a full understanding of what 1,000 years is, but I don't think that we should presume that that is a literal 1,000 years. So this is where people get the 1,000-year reign. This is the premillennial. Well, this is the millennial doctrine, and whether it's the pre-trib or post-trib, people have different views, but a lot of people hold to this literal 1,000-year reign. And it does not have to be a literal 1,000-year. In fact, it's most likely a symbolic time frame because it's in the book of Revelation, where almost everything is symbolic.
He threw him into the abyss and locked and sealed it over him to keep him from deceiving the nations any more until 1,000 years were ended. After that, he must be set free for a short time.
So you've got a long time mentioned here and a short time mentioned. The long time is said to be 1,000 years, and the short time is not specific at all. But keeping in mind that the book of Revelation is about things that must shortly come to pass, I guess I would lean toward, and I also think that most, if not all, of the book of Revelation, or at least the vision parts of it, is talking about the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. This short time that Satan would be set free to deceive the nations could have been the 3.5 years that Jesus conducted his ministry from 30 to 33 AD. Maybe Satan was let loose specifically for that short amount of time to deceive the nations so that they would reject the Messiah in accordance with God's will. That makes sense to me.
I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge, and I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony about Jesus and because of the word of God.
Now, that could be the specific 144,000, but I didn't go back and look at all the details of the comparison between those two. I feel like it's not necessarily that 144,000 Jews, 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes. But certainly it would say it would be Christians. It would be people who would be killed because of their Christian testimony of Jesus.
They had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ 1,000 years.
So if it is that 144,000, it's also talking about Jews only, because the 144,000 was specifically 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes. So if people today want to claim that in our future, Christians, the church will be raptured to reign with Jesus 1,000 years, I would like to know how they justify substituting Gentiles in for the 144,000. that were specifically Jews, and only 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes.
The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended.
All right, so there's mention here of two resurrections. One resurrection is earlier than the other one. It seems like this first resurrection would be, I guess, when Satan was imprisoned, and that 1,000-year period before he's let loose. But I don't really want to get into the details there, because I don't think I understand the details about this. But I think it's interesting that there are two resurrections pointed out. There's one for a certain group of people, and then there's one later for all the rest of the dead.
This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who share in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ, and will reign with him for 1,000 years.
So we have here two resurrections and two deaths. This second death, I generally think this is referring to spiritual death. Because we have the first death that humans experience would be physical death on earth. Or it might not be physical death on earth. It may be spiritual separation that we were all cursed with when the moment Adam and Eve ate of the fruit, the forbidden fruit. That would be the first death, and the second death would be what I consider annihilation of the spirit. And I guess that would be more consistent to completely leave out physical death, because usually when the Bible talks about death, it's not talking about physical human death. It's talking about separation from God.
When the 1,000 years are over, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, and to gather them for battle.
All right, so this Gog and Magog thing, I've done some research and looking around trying to understand it better, and there's a lot of confusion about it. But I wanted to show you one thing. This is every mention of Magog in the Bible. You've got Genesis 10 and 1 Chronicles 1, which mentions the exact same thing, which is just listing the sons of Japheth. Then you've got Ezekiel 38 and 39, and then you've got this mention here in Revelation chapter 20. So we know Magog was a descendant of Japheth. And also from Genesis 10, we know that Japheth's descendants settled up toward Europe. Ham went down toward Africa, and Shem went east toward Arabia and toward India, I guess. So Japheth's descendants were from Europe. They went to Europe, which is where Rome is. And it calls them the coastal regions, which is where Rome is, which would include Rome anyway. And in Ezekiel 38, it calls it the face of Gog in the land of Magog. So Gog seems to be a person, and Magog seems to be a location. Or it could be the location where the descendants of Magog settled. But it would not be a specific person, it would be a region, probably where Magog's descendants settled. So, I think Gog and Magog is a reference to Europe or Rome. It would certainly be consistent, I think, to, you know, Gog being a person and Magog being a region where the Magog descendants settled. Gog could be Caesar, or the leader, the ruler of the world, in the region where Magog settled, which would be up near Europe, or near Rome. So you have a reference here to Caesar of Rome.
In number, they are like the sand on the seashore.
And that would certainly be consistent with the Romans at this time.
They marched across the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of God's people, the city, city he loves.
Okay, that's also consistent with Rome at this time. Rome destroyed Jerusalem, the city that Jesus, that God loves, and the armies were as great as the sand on the seashore, surrounded the city of Jerusalem at this time. At the time, you know, Revelation was written in the 60s A.D., and Rome destroyed Jerusalem in 70 A.D.
But fire came down from heaven and devoured them, and the devil, who deceived them, was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown. They will be tormented day and night forever and ever.
All right, so the devil was also thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet had also been thrown in the previous chapter. So Rome and the unbelieving Jews were thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, and now the devil was also thrown in the lake of burning sulfur with his friends and the other enemies of Jesus. And it says, they will be tormented night and day forever and ever. Now, I often, in my conversations, point out that the Bible doesn't talk about eternal torment. This is one of the few verses in the Bible that actually talks about eternal torment. But it's also in Revelation that is highly symbolic. And it's also specifically talking about the devil, the unbelieving Jews, and the Roman Empire being tormented. It makes no mention of people today, like unbelieving people today, even people who go to hell today. There's no mention of that whatsoever. It just right here is just talking about unbelieving Jews, the Roman Empire, and the devil himself.
Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were open. Another book was open, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books.
So that tells you what the other books were, the books of recordings of what had been done. So the books of works, maybe, what you had done. And then there's also a book of life, which just has the names of God's chosen elect people, whom will receive free grace and forgiveness and mercy.
The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done.
All right, so all the dead, whether you died in the sea or for any other reason, were here before the great white throne in Judgment Day. And death and Hades are also obligated to conform to the will of God and give up those whom they were holding. And this sounds a little bit mythical or idolatrous to personify death and Hades as if they are people. So But that's kind of it's the way it looks like. It's these two terms are personified. Hades being like a realm of the dead, a holding place of the dead, and death. I don't know. It sounds a little bit like the way people depict, like the death angel that goes around, like the Grim Reaper with his. What is it? The tool that harvests grain or whatever.
Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire.
All right, so now we're adding some more people into the lake of fire. Not necessarily people, but death and Hades were thrown into the fire with the beast and the false prophet and Satan himself. Thrown into the lake of fire, or the lake of burning sulfur, which is described as the second death.
The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire.
All right, so now we've added everybody. Whoever's name is not written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. And again, we're dealing with a vision and symbolic language, but we know that we want our name to be in the book of life. That way we can receive mercy and forgiveness, because if your name's not in the book of life, you get thrown into the lake of fire. Along with death and Hades and the beast and the false prophet and the devil himself. And that is, if I get rid of these notifications, goodness. That is Revelation chapter 20.